nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hey everyone, welcome to lecture 3.6. So here we'll talk about using what we call the QCRF, or quadratic complex rational function, to improve the performance of finite difference time domain dispersion modeling, which is very helpful for photovoltaic applications. And so just to briefly go over what is this quadratic complex rational function, or QCRF. So this is essentially showing the equation. So we're assuming that our epsilon is complex value, so we have real and imaginary parts, and we can represent it in this form. Now, of course, not every material would necessarily precisely be described by this, but actually many materials can be approximated very well by this function, surprisingly, perhaps. And so this is actually oftentimes a more accurate model for semiconductors than some of the other more popular approaches, like the Drude-Lorentz model. Basically because Drude-Lorentz assumes like a very small number of resonances, whereas QCRF allows like kind of a broad range of absorber resonances that are usually what you see in semiconductors because of the band structures. And so this actually shows you can apply complex curve fitting in order to calculate all of the coefficients, A0, A1, A2, B1, B2. Right. So it's essentially like a 5x5 matrix problem. So assuming you have all the data, you can basically calculate like some certain like quantities like S0, S1, T1, and U2. Right. And so these are just like basically, intermediate quantities, which you don't certainly need to memorize. And they allow you to basically construct this solution for almost any data set. So that's a very nice capability that you can easily fit this like in all kinds of different media. And just to demonstrate this actually works, here are some examples showing like the analytic absorption curves for amorphous silicon. And then for crystalline silicon, you can see in both cases, the experimental data, which is in dots, is very closely matched by the QCRF model. And then also silver is matched almost perfectly. So you can still capture a lot of this stuff that would be modeled well in Drude-Lorentz, as well as the semiconductors that would otherwise be very hard to model. And then you can see that the absorption curve for amorphous silicon actually is closely matching with the analytic solution, like for flat structure. So that gives us pretty good confidence that this is an appropriate modeling method. May have a few percent error though. So then here's just another example. So if we have a more complex slab, we can actually also show that we can even get better than 4% accuracy for some types of materials like perovskite absorber, which has become a big topic in photovoltaics, as well as absorbers for spiroometad, which is basically a whole transport layer, and titanium oxide, which is shown here. And just to compare with actual experiments now for the actual transmission reflection, we can show, for example, from this paper a few years ago on photon management in crystalline silicon, that if we had no light trapping, absorption looks like this. And then with textured light trapping, it looks in the green. You can see you get fairly reasonable match with the simulated results, but any difference is probably more due to slight differences in the assumed and actual fabricated geometry. But in general, we can actually say that there's an analytical model for the surface geometry, which looks something like this, in which you basically assume that as you move along the surface of your textured absorber, that there's some sort of like autocorrelation between adjacent points, which is given by F, but then there's also like a random component. And then that random component goes like 1 minus F squared to the 1/2 power times the random value. Okay, and so you can also do that both in 1D and 2D textures. And you can create double side correlation to make sure that it's fully periodic. And so you can actually go over a whole range as you change this autocorrelation term F from like very high correlation where essentially the structure is very flat to something that's just a little bit textured to something that's very, very, very sharply textured. Of course, that's actually very hard to realize in experiment, but we do think if you look at the SEM images, that it kind of appears that we're in the middle of this range oftentimes. So if you compare this image from the top to like kind of the side image of this, you can actually see a lot of similarity that they're kind of these clusters or features which have peaks and valleys, much like you see there. And all depends on the scale that you're looking at, of course. So the F, the correlation factor, is not a scale-free quantity, it's a dimensionful quantity. So you'd always have to rescale it if you change the resolution. In the next lecture, we'll talk more details about photovoltaic light trapping.